Quality flared connections are necessary on all heat pump installations. Poor flaring will lead to refrigerant leaks, which leads to systems that can't provide the necessary heating and cooling, run less efficiently, and in extreme cases, damage the unit's compressor. That all impacts the installer's bottom line and reputation. In this video, Dan from the Radiant Store in Troy will walk through the steps for a high-quality flare. So with that, let's meet Dan, who is on site at a new home construction in East Greenbush.
We're just going to be demonstrating how to do a flare on a ductless split unit with a couple copper lines. So after you cut the insulation, what you're going to want to do is remove the flare nuts themselves. We're going to line up our line set, and then we're going to make a marker mark just about where we're going to cut it. Then with your copper cutters, imps or close cutters, whatever you have, you're just going to cut away the excess copper. When you're using these, if you haven't before, typically you want to tighten it down, go one full rotation, and then you're going to tighten a half a turn. And you're going to continue to do that until eventually you make your way through the copper and you get a clean cut. After the copper's been cut, you want to chamfer the ends, which is removing the inner sharp edge. And you want to also sand cloth away or wire brush any of the burrs that might be on the pipe themselves. Try to angle your pipes downward while you're chamfering and removing the burrs. That way none of the excess copper goes down inside the tube. You can use any kind of sand cloth or wire brush. I just have a typical plumbing wire brush. So after you've chamfered and cleaned the ends of burrs, you can put your flare nuts on, and make sure you do that before you make your flare, otherwise you're gonna have to cut the flare off. And when you put this on, this flaring tool, it shows you each individual size. Today we're just gonna be using 3/8 and 1/4 inch. When I was taught how to use this tool, I was told that you wanna leave roughly the depth of a dime sticking out of the actual end. And the reason is just so that you get an even distribution of the copper. And then there's an arrow on the proper side of this tool that you want to make sure lines up with the lines on the actual sizes. So we're going to go ahead and do that now. And if you see, there are hash lines right here. You want to make sure you line up with the correct one when you go ahead and tighten this down. When you tighten this all the way down, it'll spread out the copper in a ring, and that'll make like a cone shape that'll also fit to the flare nut and the flare fitting. And when you get far enough, you'll hear that click. That's basically just kind of letting you know that you've gone all the way, and now you're just cleaning off any kind of rough edges that might be on there. And it's time to go back. Loosen up. You want to make sure you loosen everything all the way before you remove this tool, otherwise you can kind of cause scratches and some damage. But as you can see, we have a nice flare. So then you can squeeze this to remove it and try to pull down and out, because if you pull off immediately, you could scar up the edges. If you have too much on the opposite side of this protruding out and you make a flare that's too large, what'll happen is when you try to get the nut to come down, it won't seat all the way like that. It'll get caught in the edge. And I've seen where people will thread it on to the actual flare, and sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't. What'll happen is there'll be excess copper, and the gaps is actually what will cause the refrigerant to leak out. So you don't want to have too much. Like I said, you want to have that nice depth of a dime sticking out. If you underflare it and it's too small, what happens is that you actually don't cover the whole entire outlet and you're gonna get leaks that way as well. So it's kind of important to make sure that you're within that small amount, but you're not too much. And then we're just gonna repeat that same process for the quarter inch line. Always make sure you double check that it's lined up correctly. So the first click is to let you know that you've reached the actual flare. The second click is to let you know that you've cleaned off the edge, made it more round than bowed, so there's no folds. Anytime there's a bad flare, I would recommend you cut it off, whether you're taking a large amount off or not, just because a bad flare can hold pressure for a while and then release it all at once, and that's kind of dangerous. Most copper cutters will actually have this channel built into them. That channel in the rollers down in the bottom is to actually fit a flare inside of it so that you can cut it nice and close and not lose much length. After this, we're gonna apply a little bit of refrigerant oil to the ends of these, and I'm gonna get a torque wrench and we'll show you how to tighten them up. Based on what kind of refrigerant you're using inside of your system, you're gonna possibly have to use different types of oil. When you're applying the oil to the ends of the flare nuts, make sure that you only do it to the face, not the threads themselves. The threads could actually not get the correct torque if they have oil on them. So we want to make sure that you apply them to the face and not to the threads. This tool is called a torque wrench. There are many different kinds of them. A lot are not digital like this. You just set them for specific foot-pounds. After that, you'll be able to apply pressure until it gives a little bit, which is like almost like the clicking that we had earlier after you reach the flare depth. It'll let you know that you've applied enough pressure to the actual nut itself. And always make sure you check in the manual to see what the foot pounds per pressure are actually recommended, because certain manufacturers will have different recommendations for their flare fitting. I'm gonna calibrate this so that it'll only apply that many foot pounds. When you are going to apply the pressure from the torque wrench, make sure you have a second wrench. This one can be any kind of crescent wrench or an adjustable, maybe some channel locks, but you need to back the flare nut itself because you don't want to apply any of that pressure to the copper lines. You want all of the torque to go into the nut. So here on the 3/8 line, we're applying 18.4 foot-pounds per pressure due to the factory specs. So you heard it get steady, that's actually what you want. Afterwards, what we're gonna do is we're gonna clean up all of this with some tape and get it all insulated. Essentially, you don't wanna have any of the copper exposed so that the moisture from the air can actually get onto the copper. If you keep this enclosed, what'll happen is it'll create its own almost isolated temperature barrier inside of there where it stays consistent, so that way you don't get water and condensation accumulating on these copper lines. If this line set was to be exposed and left outside and you didn't put it in any kind of casing like a line hide or a fortress material, you would want to make sure that it's wrapped up in some sort of UV protectant barrier. That way the sun doesn't damage this insulation over time and you don't accumulate that condensation we were talking about. If you do, it could cause some sort of damage to the lines in the future. Prior to insulating these lines, after you've done flares, what you may want to do is leave each of the flare portions exposed and then put nitrogen through the system. You'll have to check the factory recommended pressures of your system, but once you apply pressure to the system, you'll be able to leak test with a little bit of soapy bubble water, or you could even use some of the liquids that they sell at the store for that. Making sure that your flares aren't leaking is important to save refrigerant and to make sure that you don't have to come back and do the job twice.